Hello. Hello, everyone. Hi. How are we doing? How are we doing? So I need you all to do something for me. I need everybody to stand up. Get up. Up, 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 up. Fast. No time. And so I need everybody to get a partner. You need to turn to the person next to you. Everybody look. If there's nobody beside you, go to the back. If everybody has taken everybody else and there's one odd person left, come and meet me. We'll be partners. Okay, we'll be partners. That's fine. Everybody just get, everybody needs to get somebody. Have you turned to the person next to you? Then I need you to, I need each person to introduce themselves to that person. So I am Meg, or I am Chinelo. Yeah. I need you to learn that person's name. It's not just, you're going to have to do something with that name. So have we all done that? So I need you to hold that person's hand, look them deep into the eye, you know, like you're about to say something, like the universe depends on you right now. And then ask them, dear, say their name. And then ask them, are you in a box? Okay, respond now. Nobody knows because you don't even know what the box is about. Everybody clap for yourselves, you did awesome. Thank you, thank you. Now, the purpose of that exercise, first and foremostly, I just feel it's really nice to sit beside somebody and, you know, have somebody to talk to and know who you're sitting beside so that if the speaker is boring, you can just turn and smile and, you know, get yourself going. But more importantly, because we're going to be speaking a lot about boxes, and I just want us to have this at the back of our minds as the discourse goes on. Boxes. Am I in a box? Did I create a box? Was this a box and I had no idea about it? I've been introduced, Chinelo Meg Egbunonu. I'm a lawyer, a writer, and you can also call me a feminist. And the boxes I talk about are not your safety deposit boxes used in the banks or the boxes you use from moving from place to place or from packing your things up, no. The boxes I mean are anything, tangible or intangible, existing in space, in time, and in reality, for the sole purpose of placing human beings in an identifiable structure. Now, a box, like Omoye pointed out, it could be a perceived stereotype of what you should be. It could be a label. It could be a definition. It could be a notion that society has set as this is the way things are. Deal with it. Most times, we just wake up and we're born and we meet boxes and we have to walk into them and there's nothing we can do about it. It could be society's way of saying, you have arrived or you have not arrived. You are successful or you are not successful. And there are lots of boxes. There are gender boxes, there are career boxes, social status boxes, tribal boxes, food boxes. There are even boxes that we do not even know about and we do not talk about. We do not know that they are boxes and that they are living life and true. So I'm going to share something with everyone. I come from a family of seven. My mother, my father, and the five of us children. Of the five kids, I happen to be the youngest and the only female of me. And we had this nightly ritual growing up. Every night, my mom's youngest sister, Auntie Evelyn, she was my favorite aunt, by the way. And I'm not saying it because I know she'll watch this on YouTube eventually, but she was my favorite aunt. And she would make sure that she would line us all up, the five of us siblings, for us to use the bathroom every night before we went to bed. And so my eldest brother will go first, my second, the third, the fourth. And it gets to my turn, and I'd see my brothers go and do their stuff. And like clockwork for a very long time, I just go to the water closet and face it standing up and wanting to do my thing. And my aunt would tap me and say, my friend, come on, turn around. Don't you know you're a woman? And so for the hugest part of my childhood, the one thing I had disturbing me was, why I, who could do a lot of things like my brothers, I could run like them. I mean, I climbed trees and got scars on my legs like them. And I cut my hair and I wore their shirts and I was a tomboy and all that. But I was disturbed that why could I not stand up and pee like my brothers? Because I just see them go to the water closet and do their stuff and, you know, they'd be done with. And I look back on this and it makes me smile. But I've come to realize that it probably represented on some scale my first encounter with a box of some sort. And looking deeper at it, it also shows me, or it presents to me, the kind of confusion I and probably a lot of other people have had to face in life, just walking into boxes. I'm being told that is the way things are, deal with it, without as much as an explanation. So from infancy, we're all gifted with our individual boxes, how to eat, when to eat, when to sleep, what to wear. As we keep growing, these boxes grow with us. They take more definite forms and more serious undertones. We begin to understand that at every corner we turn, there are set expectations, things that we're expected to live up to. We begin to understand that society has a lot of expectations from us. Nursery school is waiting for us, from there, primary school, secondary school, university. Well, if jam doesn't like you, 3 years at home first, then university. After university, maybe NYSE, and then, you know, if you're lucky enough, get a job, get married, work till you die. And that's the progression. That's what we're expected of. And, you know, so many of us are used to this because boxes reign supreme in the adult world. We walk into, we become adults, and we're all used to these boxes because from when we've been small, we've had all these different things hit into our heads and into our brains of how things should be. We don't question them because that is how things have been. So we should just continue living with them and reigning with them. So we ask each other different questions when we meet ourselves. What do you do? Where do you work? Where do you live? What is your specialty? How many children do you have? And these are questions we ask ourselves to gain information on one another and subconsciously, you know, slot each person into their conveniently created box so that we can define them and place our label or our definition or whatever we deem fit on them. And this is the reason, to a large extent, especially in our society, a lot of people are born with these crazy aspirations and these crazy dreams and intentions, but they let them die in the recesses of their daydreams because they do not know it will be accepted. They do not feel it falls within society's normalcy, the boxes, what everybody has come to be used to. And so we have the likes of Mo Abudu, we have Chimamanda Adichie, Onyeka Onwenu, Tiwa Savage, Kafi, Omoye, beautiful people who have broken down barriers in their chosen areas of what of their career and all that, so that if we had a younger one, or maybe a kid, walk up to us and say, oh, I'd like to be like Agbani Darego when I grow up, we'll probably say, oh, so cute. But in our mind, we're like, my friend, go and sit down, go and get ready to study something serious. And so that's why, to a large extent, in our society, it's still expected that everybody should want to be an investment banker, or a doctor, or a lawyer, or an accountant, or an architect, or a wife. Yes, I said wife. And that is because in our society, the sum of a woman's achievements is in her dexterity at landing a man and becoming a wife. So that even if she were to build a bridge from Potiskum to Calgary, or run up Mount Kilimanjaro, Mount Everest in 5 seconds, or she created a cure for Ebola, HIV, Alzheimer's, cancer together, our society will still qualify her qualifications with one forwarded question: but are you married? And you know, this is not to denigrate the marriage institution. In fact, I've come to learn that marriage to the right person is an absolutely wonderful thing. But then I wonder, do we even ask ourselves if there are people who they have decided to pour themselves into the service of humanity or into their careers and do not want to be boxed by marriage? Perhaps they view marriage as a box. Is it possible? And I would like to appeal to our emotion and say this thing, this gender box in which women have been placed or what they face is peculiar to just the African or the Nigerian society. But that is not true, because globally it has even become to be recognized as the glass ceiling, meaning a woman can go so far, most times in the corporate world, but not as far as she goes, so that as you keep going higher, the number of women keep reducing. The only thing is that in our part of the world, it probably is the wooden ceiling, because we have culture and religion breathing hard and strong and reminding us of our second-class citizen status as humans in the society, that's females. And so to that extent, as a female wanting to excel, excel and female sometimes, they can't even be in the same sentence, but you would find that except you own mediocrity and you resign yourself to a life of mediocrity, you'll be required to work thrice as hard as your male equivalent in every given circumstance. Why? Because at every opportunity you have to excel, there will be near insurmountable hurdles. If you think I'm lying, ask Hillary Clinton, she will tell you. Okay, she's not from our society, but she can also share with you. And that is because the box in which females, the gender box in which we have been placed is such that he expects you to probably do well. But then, why do you want to go so far? After all, do you not know you're a woman? And then, you want to be good, or it's okay, you can be good, but all this gra-gra, you want to be the best. Don't you know you should be a mother, and you should be a wife, as though you cannot be woman, mother, wife, and excellent at the same time. And equally, the fact that you can probably use a MAC lipstick and you're really good at contouring makeup, it will kind of fashion give you offers of average or slightly below average IQ. Conversely, if you are spoken of beforehand as intelligent, intellectual, and knowledge savvy, the expectation is, oh, this heavily bespectacled, ill-fitting, male-type clothing, boring, herd person. Anything less, and they begin to ask, is she really a good fit for this position? I don't know why, that's the stereotype. And sitting on the gender box, as a female, you will learn, well, you would fight, and then to some extent, you will learn to have your strengths interpreted as weaknesses. Your leadership qualities will be spoken of as bossy. Your passion for work and your zeal will be said to be emotional. Your ambition to get to the top, they'd say it's aggressive. And you'd find that these terms are reserved for you as just a female, not just by members of the opposite gender, but by fellow females who do not understand and realize that, like you, we have all been boxed. And so when you strive to let your voice and your opinion be heard, right or wrong, you just want your opinion to be heard. You'll be relegated no longer to the kitchen or the living room, but also to the other room. I don't know where the other room is, honestly. And so, like I said before, except you decide to own mediocrity, place it on your chest and own it as a badge, wake up to it every morning and sleep with it every night. For you to excel as a female, you'd have to not just break the box or break out of, you have to do away with the box and fling it away and step out. And the same applies with all other boxes, with the social status box and the career box. And one may wonder and say, is it such a bad thing to have definitions, and would we not risk chaos and uncertainty if these boxes did not exist? But I've always wondered, what of people who, by virtue of who they are, their essence, if you might call it their complexity, they cannot be boxed. They do not have a label. They do not have a definition. They cannot have a box created for them because, by virtue of the creative things they have going upstairs. I mean, are they to be compelled to a life of waking up and sleeping, feeling non-accomplishment and underachievement because that which they do or that which they are about, it doesn't have a definition, it doesn't have a box. If we turn through history's pages, nobody ever really changed the world or left an indelible mark in being in a box, not Fumilayo or some Kuti. Not Nelson Mandela, who proved to the world that you can be peaceful and yet very activist. Mother Teresa poured herself into the service of humanity in the most unconventional manner, and Princess Diana, for the first time, proved to the world that you can actually hug a HIV patient and not fall down dead with HIV immediately. I don't know how many of us know Steve Jobs, but he's somebody who I've come to. I used to think he was this person who, you know, from 15, he just started making these gadgets and rising and rising. But when I read his story, I found myself crying because this man defied gravity. He defied every definition of failure to become the Steve Jobs we know. And even if we bring it home, let's look at Aluko Dangote. What does he do? He sells sugar. He does spaghetti. He makes cement. And now I hear he's about going into oil. What is his box? He doesn't have a box. That exactly is my point. If these people had any boxes, the box of not being boxed. And if I'm to take it further, I would want to argue and believe that President Obama of the United States was able to win the 2008 presidential elections simply because he refused himself to be reduced to the box of a color. So that way he was able to appeal to blacks, to whites, Hispanics, Chinese, all sorts of Americans, by being Obama and not by being black or whatever else anybody may have tried to create him as. And if we still take it a little down, I'm sure in the not too distant past, people who had lost their limbs from polio or some war or something, if they were given sets of forms to fill, they probably have to tick that box where they say, are you disabled? Yes, you tick it, check. But we are all living witnesses to the fact that in this day and age, there are people who have lost some limb or the other, but they have proceeded to win Olympic medals, feats that you and I that are fully bodied, we have not even won. So that to that extent, is anybody ever really disabled? No. Maybe physically challenged, but not disabled. The disabled box has been dispensed with. And that is the same thing I stand for, that most of these boxes, we do not need them. We can dispense with them. And so, yes, to come back to that question of would we not face danger if we're to do away with boxes? Not everybody must be mandatorily expected to fit into a box or a label or some definition. In fact, as my good friend Ewongosi Cleopas notes, she says, some humans are made multifaceted. To attempt to squeeze and put them into a single facet would be to defeat the core of who they are, their essence. And in my own case, I have faced my own fair share of boxes. Yes, I am a business lawyer. I enjoy corporate governance. I get my high from doing research that I can take to court and, you know, bombard the judge or my colleague on the other side with. But then I also love writing about the sun and the moon and the stars, about trees and life and death and sorrow and happiness, and about the locker room, the other room, the situation room, and what other room you can think about, even about TEDx. I enjoy writing about everything other than law. And I've had people walk up to me and say, but how can you be a serious business lawyer if you do all this, you're writing things and you put it on your blog and it doesn't have anything to do with law? And I always ask, must I be one or the other? Must I even be both? Can't I just be me and have these various things that are part of me, that form part of my complexity, if you may? And I had often heard growing up that the sum of my achievements could only come through, my crazy dreams could only come through under the coverage or the covering of marriage. My master's degree was tied to getting married. My first car was tied to my wedding day. And I smile looking back and realizing that not all of my dreams have come true, but most of them did come through with only God and hard work on my side. And yes, I love red lipstick. I love good clothes. I love to pack my hair in a nice do. And when my foot doesn't hurt, I love to wear high heels and look nice. And I enjoy Tyra Banks. And I'm not really crazy about the Kardashians, but I could do with Chloe. So yes, sometimes you'd catch me watching their show. But then I also enjoy discussing politics and global economics and international financing and sustainable development, all those intelligent things that people associate intelligent people with. And, you know, one would find me discussing the one and would think I'm totally devoid of the other, or discussing this and would think I'm totally devoid of this other. But the truth is, and I enjoy shattering those perceived notions because I have refused to be boxed. I do not have a box. I am just me, breathing, existing, and enjoying my life. And so it is sad that we live in a society that is still obsessed with boxes, with stereotypes, with giving definitions of what success is, and we're wondering how sad it is. Let me break it down to you. So we talk so much about fighting corruption. For me, it goes beyond going in the dead of the night and picking up people from their homes and all that. So let's say somebody builds a really beautiful mansion down the street, beautiful white house, high, like nobody has ever seen before, the first of its kind. What the next thing we do? We hail him, we call him sir, and honorable, and Ogwefi. We give him all these titles. We do not ask, where did his money come from? Is it from hard work? It doesn't matter. Why? Because the giving in the society is, insofar as you're wealthy, that's all we care about. And similarly, if you were to go to a function and you were to go somewhere, and somebody comes with this really nice G-Wagon, from afar, the first thing you hear is, open the gates! And then he drives right in. But then you see this gentle-looking person with his small car. Perhaps he's even a professor or a teacher or even a farmer who has poured in his life's work, honest work, into farming, and that's all he could afford. And then you see security detail. Everybody's checking his boots for the bomb because it's only that small car that can carry bomb and not the big car. And I'm still talking about these boxes and these stereotypes. We've been told from childhood how the elder is always right. And I'm not here to shake away respect. I love respect, and I appreciate the fact that in Africa, it is something that we still have in our value system. But then I ask this question of the elder is always right. So let's say you have somebody at home, a small girl, very active, probably at about 5 or 6. And all of a sudden, you notice she's been withdrawn for a while. She keeps getting withdrawn. And you begin to probe, I begin to ask, and then she lets you know how when she's asleep at night, uncle or grandpa comes into her room and does some things with her that she doesn't really understand. In your adult mind, you probably think she's molested, but you cannot speak because the elder cannot do any wrong. And even if you were to speak and the elder said he didn't do it, the elder cannot do any wrong. So we cannot talk about it. We hide it. And that is the box we live in. And so to bring it all together, you see, boxes by themselves, they may really not be a bad thing per se. But then to begin to expect that everybody should fit into a box or that we should continue to thrive on boxes that do not make sense, do not help our society grow, that in itself is a bad thing. To the guardians of boxes, I say, it really is more simple than complex. If you meet minds that you think are small enough to be placed in their box, maybe you should go ahead if you can. But then if you meet persons who, by virtue of who they are, the essence of who they are, or what they have chosen to do, they do not have a box, a label, a definition, they do not fit into stereotypes, you must not seek to cut them down and put them into that box. Rather, let that creativity, let it flame into a beautiful, beautiful fire. And to you, whoever you are, or to me, who along with the community in your head, you understand that you are creative beyond imagination, but you let that creativity die at mere insemination, even before conception, for the fear that it would not fit within society's definition or expectation of normalcy. I ask you these questions. Are you happy with yourself and with what you have? Do you know who you are and what you have? Will what you have be positively used to affect humanity? And will you be at peace with yourself? If the answer is yes, then your essence or your creativity or your complexity, it does not require any box. You should just let yourself soar and fly and excel without feeling bad that you cannot find your box. And I know we've always heard from when we're young that we should think outside the box. But to me, this saying does not sit well with me because it suggests to me that so there is a box and you live inside this box with your room and pillow and your ceiling fan and everything. But when it's time for you to think, you just come out, you think, and then you go right back into the box. But I challenge each and every one of us today, and I say, do not even think outside the box. Do away with the box entirely. Just think and act and be. Thank you.